Hey, thanks. I'm so happy to be here. And Hamline really is sort of the beating heart of who I am as a human being. So it's really exciting to be invited back. Before I took an MFA at Hamline, I worked in a cubicle. I was talking to the graduates about this. And I was a COBOL programmer. A COBOL programmer. Actually, there were so few people in the world who were doing COBOL programming at the time that they decided they would invite smart people to apply for the job, and then they would train them. I was untrainable as a COBOL programmer, so I didn't have anything to do in my job. But they kept me around. I was like the clown of the group. I wrote blog posts about silly things at the office, and then the other part of the time I worked at Wells Fargo, I wrote a novel about a guy who sat in a cubicle not knowing how to do his job. With his hair like burning from fluorescent light, and his wife didn't like the way his hands looked, and she said that his face gave her a headache. I actually thought, man, maybe I should be a writer if I can't do COBOL programming. I got sent to a loft class by somebody, and I took a loft class, and it was there that someone said to me, why don't you take a look at the MFA at Hamline? I wasn't even sure what an MFA was. But I got here, and I took my very first class, and afterwards, I ran to my car. And I got in my car, and I turned on the radio, and I started pounding the ceiling and screaming and kind of crying. Because I knew I'd found my home, I found my tribe for the first time ever. It was this remarkable experience. And that's kind of what you guys have, clearly, from sitting in that room with you today. You're like a tribe, you're like a family. It's congratulations for just finding that. If nothing else, what a wonderful thing. So to think about what a degree, an MFA degree, can do for you, I think you have to pause right now before you get any further than a few hundred miles away from here emotionally. I want you to think about sort of the things that Mary was talking about a few moments ago, the character development exercises, the beautiful writing that you did when you first got here. My first month that I was in the MFA at Hamline, I wrote about myself as a first grader. And I never really thought about myself as a first grader, but I looked like a meth head in first grade. My hair was all crazy, and I had like dark circles under my eyes, and I always had stuff sort of pasted in my face. My teeth have always been goofy, but they didn't fit my mouth right in first grade. I just looked terrible. And I had this voice in my head all the time that said, do it, do it. I had this other very weak voice that said, don't do it. Well, I wouldn't listen to it. And at one point in first grade, I jumped up on my chair during a lesson, and I stood like the Jesus Christ statue overlooking Rio de Janeiro on my chair, and everybody just paused and looked up at me, and I was like, I don't know what I'm doing. The teacher sent me out of the room, and I wrote about that confusion, the weirdness that I felt. I got in fights all the time, and I recognized that my father, who my mother and father got divorced, got remarried during that year. And I thought, wow, is it possible that there was trauma in my life that was sort of rippling out in other places? And I never thought about it before, but doing the exercises got me there. I also wrote about sixth grade church camp. And I've used this again and again in my writing, but for the first time, I wrote about it, and it was such a weird experience. Hello, my friends. It was such a weird experience. My father was Jewish and my mother was Lutheran, so I'm Jutheran. But I went to this Lutheran church camp, and I had this beautiful, really wonderful camp counselor named Larry in my sixth grade cabin. But one night something went horribly awry. Tommy Banfield had heard about cardinal sin somewhere during the day, and he said, so Larry, what is it? What's a cardinal sin? And Larry said, oh, that's one that you can't be forgiven for. And Tom said, yeah, so that's like murder or something. And Larry said, no, I think you can be forgiven for murder. And we all were. But then Tom wanted an example. And Larry said, well, It's like if you say, I hate God, that's blasphemy. If you say, I hate God. And we all sat quietly for a moment, and then Tommy said, you just said it. And I said, no, I did it as an example, and then another kid just yelled, I hate God! But the rest of us were like moths flying by a flame, but no, I didn't say it! It was this awful experience. After a couple of hours of Larry trying to convince us that we hadn't committed blasphemy, but he clearly wasn't sure, we stomped off across the darkness of the camp, and we got to the pastor's cabin and knocked on the door, and the pastor was asleep. We had to knock a lot. And finally, he came to the door, and Larry said, okay, so if I say I hate God as an example of blasphemy, have I committed a blasphemy? And the pastor went, go back to bed. Can you imagine? Larry was like 18 years old. What he cared, he thought he'd sent a whole cab of sixth graders to Hamline. I wrote about that my first month. It was amazing. I also wrote about the joy of eighth grade. There was this time in eighth grade where I'd become a breakdancer from looking at K-Towel records, a poster. You could pull out from a K-Towel record and have all the positions. And I invited Michelle Faraday and Kim Hock to do some dancing as well. And then my friends Bucky and Jason Oates came over. We put together this act in eighth grade where we were, you know, backspinning and doing the windmill and doing all sorts of amazing things and just feeling this great joy. We went to an eighth grade dance where, and it became like a solid gold dance circle with everybody clapping around the circle while we did our routine. And we became convinced at that moment that we would be professional break dancers. And so we walked out to Highway 151 in Platteville, Wisconsin, carrying a giant refrigerator box and a boom box, and we sat it down on the side of the highway, assuming that there would be a talent scout going between Dubuque, Iowa, and Madison, Wisconsin. So it seemed reasonable, and we started doing our routine, and cars were honking to get out of the way. And semi-trucks drove by so fast that we were sprayed with gravel. It was like being hit with machine gun fire. We were filled with pelts. But what joy! What, you know, being a kid like that, just loving it so hard that we had to dance by the interstate. Beautiful. It was a beautiful moment. And that's what I wrote about in the first couple of months of being here at Hamline. I return to those notebooks all the time. I return to them all the time. They're like a safe harbor. They remind me of who I want to be as a writer. They're sort of like the essential me as a writer. And when I get lost, when I start swerving around, when the commercial aspects of the work that we do start to make me cynical, I can come back to the safe harbor. Because when you enter an MFA, you know, you've got this like pure beating heart. Writing that you really care about. And so before you get too far away from it, find those notebooks, find the notes you made, remember the things that you learned right at the very beginning and use them to protect you. Because the business, you know, there's business. Business is not that great sometimes. It, you know, for most people it goes grindingly slow. You gotta find an agent in order to get anything moved, and finding an agent's hard. You gotta then have that agent sell your work, and sometimes after the victory of getting an agent, they can't place it with anybody, and then even then, you know, your work can go to an editor who you love, and it can grind to a halt, and things can move so slowly. I've worked closely with two publishers in my publishing career. I've had six editors, and I think 285 publicists. That's the daunting, you know, and you can become cynical. So coming back to sort of your beating heart and remembering why it is that you do the work that you do is really important. I haven't even talked about Goodreads. Block it right now. Never go there again. Or you might find yourself at 3 o'clock in the morning responding to somebody who's written something semi-literate about your words, and they don't know anything, you know. The business part of this can make you cynical. So first, find a safe harbor. Second, maybe come up with a little mantra based on that safe harbor. And it might change my project, but this is the one that I say to myself. I write for kids who don't want to read. I write for kids who don't want to read. I write for kids who down on me. And whenever I feel lost or beaten, or I get the itchy Goodreads finger and want to go out there and get fights with people, I remind myself, I write for kids who don't want to read. And that actually gives me all sorts of safety, because I know that I'm going to have publishers who don't really like my work very much because it's not going to sell huge. I know that if that work gets to the right hands, there's going to be some kid out there who's going to love it. I know when there are bad titles that get changed, or if there's bad artwork that gets changed, it's okay. I'm lucky to have a publisher at all, because I write for kids who don't want to read. So having that mantra can protect you too. The last thing I want to talk about to you is a little bit more abstract. I guess I call it my Tyler trope. When I was just beginning to write YA, this was 2009, I spent a lot of time teaching at Anoka Ramsey Community College, just north of the Twin Cities. And it was a great job in a lot of ways, really a lovely job in a lot of ways. I taught developmental writing and I taught composition. But I had some kids who I felt were unreachable to me, kids who would just drive me crazy. And in 2009, in the spring of 2009, this kid, Tyler, walked into my classroom. And he looked like he belonged to Michelle Bachmann's family photo. He was, like, you know, if everybody was wearing denim, you know, sitting on a log, sitting like that would be the guy sitting there next to him. And you know, I immediately read him. I read the signals that he was putting out, and I thought, I don't like this guy. He's a young fascist. He's a young racist. I don't like him. Over the course of the first couple of weeks, he actually kind of showed me that side of him. When I asked the class to do some analyzing and critical thinking, he said, that's your liberal agenda. And it was tough, and we were always just kind of going at it. And he started talking over other kids during class, laughing when other people made good points, I thought. But I wasn't a terribly seasoned teacher, and I didn't know how to handle him. I didn't know. He also cheated on quizzes. That's something. It took me until about a month before the end of the school year to finally pull him out of the hall and say, Tyler, you just shut up. Just be quiet. I don't want to hear another word from you. You can't talk over anybody else. You can't laugh at anybody else. I'm going to flunk you. And he turned kind of red, and he said, okay. And that was it. He stopped talking over people. He wrote a pretty decent paper, enough to get it through. But then on the final exam, which was a whole long grammar exam, this developmental writing course, he started cheating. And I stood in the front of the room looking at him as he was like, looking over his shoulder at this woman's paper, and I said, Tyler. And he looked up and he said, sorry. And then a few minutes later, he looked over his other shoulder at this guy's paper and started marking off answers. And I said, Tyler, eyes on your own paper. And I was starting to tremble with rage, and I was actually thinking, this is what happens when you're a racist fascist. You think it's okay. You think it's okay to look at other people's papers. That's the kind of guy you are. And the third incident, he looked over again at somebody else's paper, and I brought cookies for everybody in class, and like a maniac, I grabbed a cookie. I whipped it at Tyler, and I expected it just to blow up on the back wall, on the back of it, but instead it like curved, and it was like in slow motion, and I was like, it blew up on his forehead. And he looked up and everybody in the class came and looked up. And I said, guys, I'm angry. It's not funny. And I thought, I'm going to get fired. I'm going to get fired. I just destroyed my own livelihood. I'm going to get fired. He turned in his paper and he said, sorry, sorry. And he left. And I could have flunked him because he was cheating, but I didn't. Because I was fearful of him telling somebody that I hit him in the head with a cookie. That's my level of morality. And who's going to tell me? And I went into that summer so fearful of Tyler telling on me. But it never came up. And I went, I wrote with another Hamline grad, Sam. We wrote funny stuff all summer long. And I kind of forgot about him. And during that summer, my son grew, and he got the stinky armpit that I've described to some of you before. And he stopped reading, so I really started writing YA hardcore. Like, I wanted to write books that my stinky son would read. One of the characters in that book falls in love, Felton Einstein, falls in love really hard. And I had this notion in my head that, you know, there were these two African-American girls, they were sisters, they were 17, 18 years old when I was 10, and I just loved them. They were my hometown. I would follow them around the grocery store, like, oh my God, you're beautiful. You're so beautiful. And I thought, Felton, he's gonna fall in love with one of those girls, and then it's gonna feel real because I knew the emotion. And then I had this other voice in my head, sort of the do it, don't do it voice, that said, you know, you've got so many things going on in this book already. Why would you bring race into a small town book? Why would you do it? And I thought, oh man, I don't know. And I kind of got stuck. At the end of the summer, I looked at my class list for composition, and I could not believe it. Tyler was on my composition list. And I thought, he's going to blackmail me. He's not going to do any work, and he's going to hold over my head and physically abuse me with cookies. I was just terrified. And my, you know, just felt sick the first day of class. I walked into class and just sat in front of the room going, oh, I'm wrong. And he didn't come in, and I began to think, oh, he realized he signed up with another class, and he just thought, no way, absolutely no way. Then right before the class was supposed to start, here he comes. He walks in the door and he's like, I was like, hi, Tyler, how are you doing? He walked to the front of the class and he sat down. There was a young African American woman who walked in right behind him and sat down next to him. And he said, hey, Herbach, this is my girlfriend, Natalia. I told her to take your class. And I was like, I don't know anything. Tyler was super respectful the whole semester. He actually wrote pretty decently. He laughed at my jokes instead of laughing at me, which made me happy. But the biggest thing was he loved this girl, man. He loved her. And she loved him back. I mean, they were just inseparable. And I thought, I don't know anything. And that was sort of the catalyzing moment for me, for just going for it in my book. And it's the thing I think of all things I've ever written that I'm most proud of, is the relationship between Felton and Aaliyah that felt so real to me and that I was afraid of putting in until freaking Tyler showed me the way. Tyler. So to end, I just want to read something that George Saunders, a nice author, good author, wrote. You know, and I want to say, I just said George Saunders and I thought, geez, the authors in this MFAC program have so much blame, I almost decided not to come today. I'm not so scared. So congratulations to all of you, but you terrify me. So George Saunders wrote an essay in the Brain Dead Megaphone. In all things, we are the victims of a misconception from afar. There's the idea of a city, and the city itself, too great to be held in mind. There's the idea of Tyler. And Tyler himself, too great to hold in my mind. And it's the gap between the conceptual and the real where aggression appears. No place works any different from any other place, really, beyond mere details. The universal human laws, need, love for the beloved, fear, hunger, periodic exaltation, the kindness that rises up naturally in the absence of hunger, fear, pain, are constant, predictable, reliable, universal, and are merely ornamented with the details of local culture. What a powerful thing to know that one's own desires are mappable onto strangers, that what one finds in oneself will most certainly be found in the other, perhaps muted, exaggerated, or distorted, yes, but there nonetheless, and thus a source of comfort. He goes on to write, I counsel myself, F concepts. Don't be afraid to be confused. Try to remain permanently confused. Anything is possible. Stay open forever, so open it hurts, and then open up some more until the day you die, world without end. Amen. So in sum, remember what you wrote here? Remember how it felt to learn and to open? Remember me just pounding on my ceiling because I was opening up? Maybe make a mantra. I write for kids who don't want to read. I write for kids who don't want to read. And then that thing, open up, stay open. So open it hurts, and then open up some more, world without end. Amen. Congratulations, you guys. Way to go.